In this video, we're going to talk about rank and about the solutions to AX equals 0. Okay? So, the rank of a matrix is just the number of pivots you get when you put it in row-echelon form or reduced row-echelon form. I mean, definition is reduced row-echelon form, but once you've gotten it to row-echelon form, you're not going to create or destroy any pivots. So, getting it to row-echelon form is enough to figure out the rank. Now, the reason the rank is important is it's going to tell us how many solutions you can have. It's going to tell us dimensions of various spaces. And in particular, it's going to tell us what happens when you solve AX equals 0. So here's a system of equations. You know, four equations and four unknowns, it's looking fairly ugly. But whenever you have a system of equations like that, you can use matrices as shorthand for it. You can separate out all the coefficients, and you realize that the right left-hand side is exactly what you get when you take this matrix here and multiply it by the vector x. You can see that what you have on the left-hand side is, you know, x1 times the first column, x2 times the second column, x3 times the third column, x4 times the fourth column. That's what the columns mean, and the rows are the equations. The first row of your matrix is essentially the first equation. The third row is the third equation, and so on. So now, what can you do to solve a system of equations? Well, you can certainly take an equation and multiply it by 3 or divide it by 7. Rescaling equations doesn't change your answers any. And if you add a multiple of one equation to another, that doesn't change your answer any. And if you swap the order of the equations, that doesn't change the answer any. So if you rescale a row, or you add a multiple of a row to another, or you swap the order of rows, that doesn't change the answers. Well, those are exactly our row operations. So whenever you do a row operation, you don't change the answers to the system of equations. So if A and B are matrices that are row equivalent means that starting with one of them, you can get the other by row operations. And then, of course, you could reverse the row operations and get the first one from the second. So you can go either direction. So if they're row equivalent, then whatever the solutions are to AX equals 0, those are the same solutions you would have to BX equals 0, because you can convert these equations to these equations by rescaling the equations, adding a multiple of one to another, or swapping the equations. And in particular, it means that if you have any old matrix and you want to figure out the solutions to AX equals 0, well, you can do your row operations to convert A to the reduced row echelon form. And the solutions to ARREF x equals 0 are the same as the solutions to AX equals 0. So in our example, you know, the way we solve AX equals 0 is we first compute the reduced row echelon form, and from the reduced row echelon form, you can basically read off the answers. So the rest of the video is how to read off the answers. So for example, this was our matrix. And in the last video, we computed that this was the reduced row echelon form. Great. So now we've got four equations in four unknowns. One of them is pretty silly. It's 0x plus 0x1 plus 0x2 plus 0x3 plus 0x4 equals 0. But the other three give us real information. And you see, we have three pivots. The rank, which we usually use the letter K to denote the rank, is the number of pivots. There's a pivot, there's a pivot, there's a pivot. Now, associated to each pivot is called a pivot variable. This is in the first column, so we say x1 is a pivot variable because it's 1x1 plus stuff. This is in the second column, so x2 is a pivot variable. In the fourth column, x4 is a pivot variable. So we have three pivot variables, x1, x2, and x4. In general, if you have a matrix of rank k, you have k pivot variables. And the remaining variables are called free variables. So if you have an n by m matrix, you have as many variables as you have, sorry, m by n matrix, so this should be an n, you have as many variables as you have rows, as many variables as you have columns, some of the columns have pivots, the rest don't. The columns without pivots correspond to free variables. And let's see what the equations mean. So here is our matrix. and we translate that to equations. The first row is x1 plus 4x3 equals 0. Second row is x2 plus 2x3 equals 0. Third row is x4 equals 0. Fourth row is 0 equals 0. That one doesn't really tell us anything, so we essentially have three equations and four unknowns. Now, the great thing about reduced row echelon form is that there's one and only one equation with an x1 in it. So we can think of this as an equation for x1 in terms of the free variable. This is an equation for x2 in terms of the free variable. We put the free variables on the other side of the equation, and we get x1 is minus 4x3, x2 is minus 2x3, x4 is 0, and I'm going to add in one more equation, that x3 is equal to x3. Doesn't really tell us anything new, but now we've got all of the components of x written in terms of x3. So in other words, x is an arbitrary number, x3 is free, it can be whatever number you want, times negative 4, negative 2, 1, 0. The solutions to our system of equations are all multiples of negative 4, negative 2, 1, 0. Let's do one more example. In our additional example, we start off with this 3 by 5 matrix. You put it in reduced row echelon form, you get this matrix, and you see, aha, the rank is 3 because I have 3 pivots. X1, x2, and x4 will be pivot variables. X3 and x5 will be free variables. We write down our equations. We put everything on the right-hand side, and then we put in our extra equations. X3 is x3, x5 is x5, and we've just written that x is x3 times 1, negative 2, 1, 0, 0, plus x5 times negative 1, 2, 0, negative 2, 1. And there we go. Any linear combination of 1, negative 2, 1, 0, 0, or negative 1, 2, 0, negative 2, 1 is a solution. So how many solutions do you have? Well, how many free variables do you have? That's n minus the rank. So that tells you about how to find, what we really found is a basis for the space of solutions. The space of solutions is also called the null space of A. We have found a basis for the null space.